is coming from, you know, the Sermon on the Mount, in this big section where Jesus is teaching about the kingdom of heaven. And, you know, Jesus has just kicked off his public ministry. He gathered his first disciples. At the end of chapter 4, Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness from among the people. And then, in verse 5, we start this morning. Large crowds have begun to follow him. And so Jesus sits down to teach. In order to understand today's gospel lesson, we have to understand what comes before. You know, it's always important when interpreting the scriptures to look at the context around the verses that we are reading. Let's put it this way. Have you ever walked in the middle of a conversation and then you're like, wait, what? Like, you walk in the office one morning and you just hear a co-worker said, and that's the last time I rent a car without checking the trunk. Or, and that's when the police showed up. And you're like going, huh? What's the rest of the story? What's going on here? Don't you wish you had some context? Sometimes when we read the Bible, it's like walking right into the middle of a conversation. We kind of get things snipped out and not see the bigger picture. And we can't understand certain passages unless we understand their context, the first part of the conversation. We don't want to base our understanding of God on a Bible verse that is taken out of context. Throughout history, too much evil has been done in the name of God by those who take a passage out of context and claimed that represents God's will. Taking a Bible verse out of context can most often not lead to a true understanding of God. And it certainly doesn't lead to spiritual maturity. For today's Bible passage, it's especially important to understand the first part of the conversation. I mean, if you were just brand new Christian opening up your Bible here, wouldn't you be in big trouble? As we have already seen, Jesus starts off his public teaching with his favorite subject, the kingdom of heaven. And he teaches us that our righteous acts don't earn our way into God's kingdom. Instead, he says, those who are poor in spirit, those who mourn, those who are persecuted for God's sakes are blessed in God's kingdom. You know, that's some revolutionary, mind-blowing stuff for Jesus' audience. But then he seems to go in the opposite direction. He tells the crowd that he didn't come to abolish the law, but to fulfill every single word. And then Jesus really confuses everyone in the crowd by saying, for I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. And you can imagine they're saying, well, how's that even possible? The Pharisees and teachers of the law can barely keep the law perfectly. Or maybe not quite. How could anyone else surpass that level of righteousness? And now that Jesus has everyone's attention, we can't get to is challenging everything that they think they know about religion. And so the scene is set for today's lesson, and it begins. You've heard it said to the people long ago, you shall not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you, anyone who is angry with a brother or sister will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to his brother or sister, Raka, is answerable in court, and anyone who says, you fool, will be in danger of hell. Whoa. It's difficult to feel self-righteous when even your thoughts are under scrutiny. Jesus is saying that it is a sin to harbor an angry thought. And he adds that if you even look at a woman lustfully, you've already committed adultery with her in your heart. That's extreme. Christianity 101 just jump to an advanced graduate course? Maybe we need to step back a little bit and see what Paul had to say to those folks in Corinth. Paul addressed the recipients of his letter as brothers and sisters, but he says, really, he feels compelled to talk to them as infants. You know, this isn't the kind of baby talk that it's expressive of vulnerability. It's not part of trying to develop some special bond. No, this is more in line with scolding. He has to baby talk them as spiritual toddlers because they need to go back and review the basics. He's heard about the jealousy and quarreling. How can you love God and love your neighbors and be fighting? So he said to them, now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you'll be in agreement. There'll be no division among you, but that you'll be united in the same mind and the same purpose. For it's been reported to me that there are quarrels among you. So following up on that in today's reading, Paul says he cannot speak to them as spiritual people, by which he seems to mean as spiritual grown-ups. Instead, he must speak as though they are infants in Christ, spiritual beginners. He doesn't want to talk to adults in baby talk tones or limit himself to subjects that only babies can understand. You can tell it irritates him, it worries him. That comes clearly through his words. These big babies need to start growing up. As it is, they're still taking the verbal equivalent of milk rather than solid food. Apparently, one of the squabbles in the Corinthian church had to do with which teacher, Paul or Apollos, gave authoritative direction in the faith. The Corinthian believers were becoming groupies and arguing their preacher preference. Paul, however, sees this as a kind of idolatry, and he seeks to speak simply. He points out that both men contributed to their understanding, but it was God that gave the growth. Then he goes into baby talk mode. You can just imagine a teacher with a bunch of little kids going, "Now, boys and girls, my lovelies, we all love others here. An apostle loves you, and you know that I love you. And let's all hold hands now and sing, 'Jesus loves me, this I know,' and let's try to get along. Because both Apollos and I, well, we really want you to know that God loves you. And that we're all God's beautiful children. So let's grow together in God's wonderful grace, you sweet little babies." Paul perhaps had it in mind, his own spiritual journey. Elsewhere, in the same letter, he speaks of its maturity in a way that makes it sound like it becomes an arrival point. "When I was a child, I spoke as a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became adult, I put the childish things away." It's from the love chapter, chapter 13. Oh, if only it was that simple. There is truth to what Paul says, of course, but adulthood isn't a threshold that we step over at a predetermined age. Biological maturation doesn't automatically equal emotional and spiritual maturation. You know, a person may be able to vote and drink and drive. They may be well beyond all those things, and it still doesn't mean he or she is mature. For even adults can act like kids. It's not uncommon to see adults in such selfish behaviors as selfishness, tantrum throwing, impatience, name calling, bullying, gossiping, keeping score and getting even, over-dramatization, shirking blame, avoidance behavior, and having problems with impulse control. Does that sound like some physical grown-ups that you might know? Many of us have our moments. We have moments of maturity, and sometimes we have those moments of immaturity. But in difficult and serious situations, I hope that we strive for the mature response and not the childish response. In terms of our faith, we can do the same thing. Staying too near our very first understanding of Christian discipleship. Homiletics magazine put together these lists, and I think they really nailed it. Here are some symptoms of spiritual immaturity. Holding the belief that faith will make you prosper or at least protect you from great troubles. Thinking of prayer as a shopping list of requests. Struggling with the same weakness with no success. An earlier generation of Christians called this besetting sins. Expecting just have an ongoing spiritual high. Hanging your faith on a human leader. Well, doesn't it sound just like those folks in Corinth? Believing that the main reason for going to church is for what having the binding certainty that your understanding of faith is right. And therefore, anyone who sees faith differently, well, they must certainly be wrong. But let's contrast that with some symptoms of spiritual growth. Understanding that faith is neither a guarantee of prosperity nor protection from trouble, but a certain knowledge that God is with you. Using prayer as a way to make yourself vulnerable to God. Having more success in the struggles with those besetting sins, but also a greater understanding that salvation isn't something you earn, but is a gift of God. Hanging your faith on Christ, despite how human leaders serve him or fail to serve him. So I hope you're not all depending completely on me, because I'll let you down every time. But I'll help you muddle through and we'll find our way together. Realizing that going to church is both what you receive and what you give. Grasping that others' understanding of faith doesn't have to be wrong for yours to be what is God's truth for you. So one form of spiritual growth is to study how certain problems or issues in our lives can interfere, hold us back as growing as disciples of Jesus. And when this discovery has occurred, we can offer these issues to God in a prayer. So when we can pray something like this, Lord, I'm trying to follow your son, but self-centeredness, or you can put whatever you're struggling with right at that time, right in there, creates a bottleneck in my life. Help me to surrender this hindering sin and open a wide thoroughfare to your presence. Or we can even start a little further back, praying to God to reveal to us what hindrances are there in my life, what sins are keeping me in being in a vital relationship with you, God. And we can say wholeheartedly those sorts of prayers we're getting off the milk. We're starting to work on solid food. And then we can start to understand Jesus' extreme teachings about the importance of our actions and our intentions